3, 2, 1. You are live, sir. Please start. Mohit sir, you are live. Please start.
Good evening, friends. Welcome to the PG Track program of Delhi CSI. And we are into the 16th webinar today. And it's such a pleasure to connect to you again. And as the exams are approaching, many of the residents and many of the doctors are asking for the focus sessions on topics of common interest like cyanosis and like rheumatic heart disease and spotters. So here we are again bringing a very clinically relevant topic today on cyanosis in adult, which is a very common case asked in exam. Today we'll be having discussions on the topic on the causes of cyanosis and what are the ways we have to approach cyanosis in adult and what are the simple tips and tricks through which we can easily stride over the difficult case. And we have the privilege of having Professor Jamal Yusuf, who's professor of cardiology in the Department of Cardiology, GB Pant Hospital. We have Professor Sumodh Kurian, who's a pediatric cardiologist in the Department of Cardiology, GB Pant Hospital. We have Professor Arima Nigam, who's an associate professor of cardiology in this same department. And we have Professor Ramakrishnan today joining us from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, who'll be speaking on the topic. So over to our panelists to start the session rolling, and hope you enjoy the session.
Professor Ramakrishnan is a very good clinician and a supremely talented interventionist. He's a great all-rounder in the field of cardiology. And besides this, he's a very helpful and a humble guy. I would request him to kindly deliver his lecture, which is going to be his third lecture in this current series of webinars. Professor Ramakrishnan, please.
So, thank you. I think, can I have my sharing allowed? Yeah. So, thank you, Dr. Mohit. Thank you, Delhi CSA. And thank you, Dr. Jamal Yusuf, for a kind introduction. So I think all of you are aware that in your examination, you can't escape one valve heart disease and another one an adult with cyanosis. These are like the questions are out. You know that what is going to come. So these two cases are always going to be there. A valve heart disease patient and an adult 20-year-old, 18-year-old sitting with cyanosis. These two are always going to be there in your examination. So what should be the stepwise approach and what should be the tips and tricks? This is the topic that I've been given. So one. Yeah. So most important one that you have to understand is, I think when you're discussing about cyanosis, we should not forget a very common commodity, but which becomes extremely rare in the examination. That is common sense. So commonly in the exams, there is no sense, oftentimes. See, this is exemplified by the people present and interpret the findings in congenital heart disease. So congenital heart disease, hardly anything will be there. There will be only one murmur or another additional murmur. There could be few additional sounds and the S2 will be single. This is what a common garden finding that you will get in a cyanosis with adult. That's all you're going to get. And out of which so much khichdi is made by the students commonly without a basic understanding of what is what. So I think the most important thing that is very essential to interpret is it's very simple. There is hardly a few diseases that can present in adulthood with cyanosis. So there are very few differential diagnoses. So it's very simple and very easy. If you follow a methodical pattern, it is very easy and keep your common sense in focus. So what we need is interpretation of finding. We don't need a complete diagnosis, right? Second important is always keep it very simple. So if you don't keep it simple, you will end up being stupid in any field of medicine and more so in congenital heart disease in adults. So you just have to keep it very simple. And the most important thing is, the only most important trick is that don't try to trick yourselves. So don't come up with some vague diagnosis which you have never seen in your life because of some vague finding, which is not very important, which is not reproducible, which is not reliable. So always stick to the basics. Stick to the common ones. There are very few. At the end of the lecture, you will understand it's such a simple thing why we make so much fuss about a cyanosis sitting in front of us. So, adult with cyanotic congenital heart disease, what are we likely to encounter in an examination? Are commonly TOF or TOF-related physiology, various conditions of TOF physiology. Out of the variants of TOF could be there like pulmonary atresia, are very rarely you can find a patient with PS with ASD. So these are the diseases of most commonly likely to encounter. The second group is Eisenmenger syndrome. The other group, miscellaneous group, the most commonly encountered patient is going to be an Epstein anomaly. So out of this, the miscellaneous group is so uncommon that generally in most of the DNB centers, at least you are likely to encounter some form of tetralogy physiology or some palliated surgery or some surgical patient operated CHD or Eisenmenger syndrome. These are the diseases that are likely to encounter. So before this, can I ask you one question? What are the commonest heart disease at birth? Tetralogy of Fallot, transposition of great arteries, total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage, or single ventricle? Which is the most common, the commonest cyanotic congenital heart disease at birth? So most of you will be thinking it is tetralogy of Fallot. But look at the incidence. The transposition of great arteries incidence is 0.34, whereas tetralogy is 0.23. Hypoplastic left heart is 0.26. Pulmonary atresia is 0.15, half of nearly equivalent to tetralogy. But the basic problem is why we often encounter everything is tetralogy after, say, around 2-3 years of age is because the survival is vastly different. Like, so the one-year survival in transposition of great arteries is around 20%. If you take only the intact ventricular septum, it falls to around 10%. So total anomaly pulmonary venous connection at 1 year, 88% of the 82% are dead. So pulmonary atresia, 70% are dying. So in tetralogy, I think only 30% are dying and 70% are surviving. That is why beyond the first year of life itself, tetralogy becomes the most common cyanotic congenital heart disease. So you can approach cyanosis in adults in this fashion, where I think common defects with expected survival, or you can have some uncommon defects with expected survival, where there are the third group is uncommon defects in which adult survival is exceptional. So the most two common things are TOF and Eisenmenger syndrome, as I told you, and uncommon defects with expected survival are Epstein's anomaly and PS with ASD. So in nutshell, if you cover all of them, then I think most of the things are done. So rest of the things like transposition, univentricular heart, truncus arteriosus, tricuspid atresia, TAPVC, all those things are very uncommon with the adult survival is exceptional. So, but you should know that anything is possible. Like I think this is often some of the examiners are fond of asking. So what are the oldest survivor reported? For example, TGA can be 56. You often guess around 50 to 60 most of the time it will be right. And most of the common condition like CCTGA where exceptional survival is well known, it can actually be 91 years is the oldest reported. Like, so if you say around 60, you'll be always right. Like what are the oldest survivor with some heart disease somebody exams ask you, it is actually 60 is a good answer. So coming to the basic tips and tricks, how do you approach an adult with CCHD? So what are the possibilities? So as I told you repeatedly, TOF or something like TOF-like physiology, Epstein's Eisenmenger syndrome and Epstein's anomaly and others. So in nutshell, everything is going to be, the $1 million is going to be, is it tetralogy or Eisenmenger syndrome? Because Epstein has very typical features on examination and has very typical findings and commonly a different set of presentation. So actually the most common thing that you will be encountering is either a tetralogy or an Eisenmenger syndrome. So how do you differentiate between them in a historical, from the history alone? From history, how do you differentiate? Is what is the onset of cyanosis? So if the onset of cyanosis is very early, it's likely to be tetralogy like physiology. And then cyanotic spells are there and the history of squatting is there or not. So we'll come to the exceptions always. There will be exceptions in Eisenmenger syndrome also. For example, some percentage of patients can have squatting. So all those things are there. Some of this complex Eisenmengers can have cyanosis at birth. So that is also there. But if the cyanosis is within 1 year of life, if there are cyanotic spells, history of cyanotic spells, if there is categorical history of squatting, then likely to be tetralogy is the clear-cut answer. So what are the various differences? Cyanosis is generally variable in tetralogy. You can have a pink tetralogy to an absolutely pink, absolutely pale jamun type tetralogy. Eisenmenger is generally, by and large, is mild cyanosis will be there. Heart size is almost always in tetralogy will be normal. In most of the Eisenmengers, it will be normal. So S2 will be single always in tetralogy physiology, whereas S2 will be variable. We will be coming to know about Eisenmenger's various forms. So never you will have a palpable PA or a palpable P2, but in Eisenmenger, it can be there. So thrill may be present. Generally, Eisenmenger's, the murmurs are rarely of any significance. Generally, you get 2/6 EDM. 2/6 murmurs, systolic murmurs, and then you can have rarely EDM of PR. Whereas murmurs of various grades can happen in tetralogy physiology, and the PR murmur can be here in tetralogy also in an absent pulmonary valve syndrome. So X-ray, we won't be going into that. So in nutshell, the most important differentiating feature is most often than not is the degree of cyanosis. Is the degree of cyanosis that commonly differentiate between an classically differentiate between an Eisenmenger syndrome and a tetralogy physiology. And the most importantly, what are the accompanying findings? Is there evidence of PH is there or not? So these are the ones that are going to determine what is going to be your diagnosis. So coming to the X-ray part, I think Eisenmenger and tetralogy will have the classic boot shape with reduced pulmonary blood flow. The Eisenmenger will have all the evidence of PH, but they also, in addition, will have telltale signs of increased QP. That means that some of the dilated vessels, especially in the central mediastinum, may be more prominent in Eisenmenger syndrome. This is how you will differentiate this X-ray from an IPH X-ray. So the telltale signs of previous, that means that for some point of time, there would be increased QP that would be flowing. So that increased QP will be reflected as some engorged vessels here and there, mostly in the central hilar part, and peripheral part will be generally oligemic in Eisenmenger syndrome also. And most of the common garden varieties of tetralogy and Eisenmenger syndrome will not have cardiomegaly. So another important thing some of the most important clues is at what age the diagnosis is made and at what age cyanosis or heart failure started. So like, for example, this is a very commonly asked question, like when do heart failure starts in congenital heart disease? Like when you think of the heart failure. So mostly we all know that beyond the 1 to 2 months, all these VSD, PDAs, all of them will start having symptoms, heart failure symptoms will start. Whereas transposition complex can start from say around less than 1 week to 1 week, and it can continue for the first year of life. And then within birth to 7 to 2 hours, heart failure occurs with generally the atresia of valves and critical stenosis of valves. Or rarely it can be because of regurgitation lesions. Whereas hypoplastic left heart and right heart syndromes is few days to few weeks. So coarctation can present commonly with heart failure in the initial neonatal age group and early infancy, and then later on can present with heart failure. In between, it doesn't present. So the two common conditions which has this kind of a bimodal presentation is one is coarctation of aorta, and another one is Epstein's anomaly, classically presents with neonatal Epstein's and later on presents around second, third decade with symptoms. This is about heart failure, including all cyanotic and acyanotic congenital heart disease. But this is a very important slide that you have to understand. What is the time of onset of cyanosis in a given patient? Suppose somebody gets cyanotic at birth. That, as I told you, TGA is the first possibility. Then you can have pulmonary atresia or critical tetralogy. You can have obstructed TAPVC. You can have HLHS and Epstein's anomaly. This is for first week. From first week to 2 months, you can have TGA, pulmonary atresia. Epstein generally goes away. So TAF, TAPVC and HLHS all remain. So few months to few years, everything becomes tetralogy. Tetralogy, tetralogy, tetralogy. Beyond first decade, it is tetralogy, tetralogy, tetralogy. Then you can have Eisenmenger syndrome and Epstein's, and then some balanced physiologies can happen. Beyond third decade, you commonly start developing tetralogy, ASD Eisenmengers, and some CCTGA, VSD PS, and single ventricle PS are the common ones that have starting of cyanosis at around third decade of life. So this is a common thing. This is like, why this is asked this repeatedly? Like, as I told you in the valve presentation also, the way you present the case, the way you come up to your final diagnosis are going to be the same as you do it in undergraduate, postgraduate. The only thing that differentiates a DM examination from an undergraduate or postgraduate examination is the understanding of natural history of each of these diseases and your in-depth understanding of the hemodynamics of these diseases. So these are the two important area that you actually are adding upon. So that means, what is the natural history of TGA? What is the natural history of tetralogy? So all those things is something that you should be aware of. That is the key thing about preparing for us. The TOF will be the same. Same TOF will be an undergraduate case. Same TOF will be kept in a MD exam also. Same tetralogy will be kept in a DM exam also. The way things are differently analyzed will be about natural history and the hemodynamics. These are the two important things that you should be well aware of. So what are the other things that actually from history you can find out? So as I told you, age at cyanosis, presence or absence of heart failure, And is there signs of heart failure and failure to thrive in early infancy? That indicate that possibly it was an increased pulmonary blood flow situation, which has later on converted into an Eisenmenger kind of situation. Or rarely you can have an increased QP situation that has actually was associated with the cyanosis, like for example, a TA-PVC or a TGA that became Eisenmenger. Or it can be a top tetralogy, top with absent pulmonary values, well known to produce failure to thrive and symptoms like heart failure. Something like hemoptysis can be there both in tetralogy as well as Eisenmenger syndrome. And specific history of a palpitation, which is classical of tachycardia, is found in pathways which are commonly associated with Epstein's anomaly, AV canal defect, CCDGA, and some kind of single ventricle pathway, the heterotaxis syndromes. And history of syncope generally should be more consistent with PS, or rarely can be Eisenmenger syndrome, or it can be because of AV blocks in AVSD, CCDGA, and heterotaxis syndromes. So coming to specifically the TAW physiology, so how do you approach among the TAW physiology? What are the characteristic features of a tetralogy physiology that you should be aware of? And how do you dissect out which of the tetralogy physiology that you are dealing with? So what are the typical hemodynamic or the morphological feature of a tetralogy physiology is any form of unrestricted VSD, a pulmonary stenosis leading on to central cyanosis. So it will fall under CCHD with decreased pulmonary blood flow. And the physiology will be right to left shunting happening at the ventricular or at the aortic level will be there. So what are the common features about cyanosis in tetralogy? The history of cyanosis will be rest or at carrying or activity. So if a patient is acyanotic and you are presenting like a pink tetralogy, always remember to do exercise saturation. That's a very important thing. Any cyanotic angular heart disease, if the saturation is borderline, always perform exercise saturation, especially if the patient is hemodynamically stable, is not class 4 or anything. So 25% are cyanotic at birth and 75% are cyanotic by first year of life. And the reverse happens in terms of survival. The late appearance of cyanosis, commonly asked question is why the cyanosis doesn't appear at birth. Why it happens generally by around 2 months of life? It is because of progressive increase in oxygen demand of the growing child. There could be increasing PS. And birth, there is a change, slow change from hemoglobin F to hemoglobin A, which is a better carrier for oxygen than the later one. And generally, by and large, tetralogy physiology have chubby childs. All those PS physiology have chubby normal growth and normal weight gain will be there. So squatting is a very important differentiating features. And most commonly, you will be asked how squatting relieves cyanosis. The common answers are with squatting, there is SVR increases, the diversion of blood flow from RV to PS, so that there's a pulmonary blood flow is increased. So I think everything, when you are discussing in a tetralogy like physiology, where everything is there, there's an obstruction, there is a large VSD, the amount of blood shunting will be determined by the relative PVR and SVR changes that happens, like fever, what happens, in anemia, what will happen. All of them you should be able to tell based on the basic understanding of physiology. You should not be mugging them up, or we should not be really, it's very simple to understand. So whenever the one circuit resistance goes down, the blood goes the other way. The blood comes that way. Wherever there is an increase, the blood goes the other way. More importantly, squatting decreases the venous return from the leg, which has the lowest oxygen saturation. But most importantly, some other series have reported 3 to 10% of Eisenmenger syndrome, especially in countries like ours, have squatting. So squatting commonly disappears by adolescent age group because I think adolescents don't feel like getting into a squatting position. They know various other equivalents. They tend to do various other equivalents like sitting with legs drawn downwards, leg crossed while standing. So some form of mother holding infant with leg flexed upon all equivalents of squatting. Another way squatting relieves cyanosis could be reduction in the sympathetic output because of the rest component that comes with squatting. And one of the most important characteristic feature of a tetralogy like physiology is cyanotic spell. So one of the common question is age at which spells occur, commonly 2 months to 2 years, generally 6 months to 2 years, the most common time, especially in the early morning. So we don't know why mechanism of spell, we really don't know what is the mechanism. Wood's theory says that it is all because of infundibular spasm, that is catecholamine release that leads to increased contractility and infundibular narrowing. But the problem with this theory is that even patients with pulmonary atresia develop spells, clearly, clear-cut spells. So then definitely infundibular spasm alone cannot explain. So one of the things was paroxysmal hyperpnea, venous return and more right to left shunt is one possibility, or mechanoreceptors in RV, And the other theory is that vulnerable respiratory center could be one of the theories that are there. And some of them have suggested atrial tachycardia. It definitely could be a precipitating factor, but whether that can explain every spell, we don't know. The vulnerability of center or the overactivity of the respiratory center to minor changes in PCO2 and PO2 has been proposed as a mechanism of spell. But that can actually explain the myelination is complete. So possibly that can explain why these spells disappear after 2 years of life, but none of the theory can explain everything about spell. So I don't know which is the right theory, which is the correct theory, but you should be aware of all the nuances of all these theories. Like, especially with tetralogy is a bad case, for example. Like, for example, if you go to a surgical exam, hernia is a bad case. I think same way tetralogy is a bad case because hardly anything is there. You'll have one ESM, you'll have one P2, and no cardiomegaly, nothing, no other finding. So your examination finding will finish in five minutes. So the examiner is going to grill you in various other things like some of the basic pathophysiology, the hemodynamic understanding of what happens with this, what happens with that. So how much you understand is what is being asked, like, most of the time. So coming to the examination in a typical tetralogy like physiology, almost all of them carry the same finding. I will come to the differences later on. So JVP is absolutely normal. Maybe you can find an AVA which is prominent in adults. Commonly, there is no cardiac sign, no heart failure, no or mild parasternal impulse, very rarely beyond 2/3. And systolic thrill is uncommon. S2 is almost always invariably single. Ejection systolic murmur, the murmur is inversely proportional to sinusoidal. I think I don't have to teach in DM final year going students. So diastolic period is clear, no S3 or no S4. So basically, nothing is there. So you just find a normal JVP or AVA may be prominent in some of them. No cardiomegaly, no nothing, no precardial bulge, nothing. Everything is simple. One murmur commonly, which is generally an early peaking murmur, and a S2 is single. This is what you find in a typical common garden tetralogy. But there are various other tetralogy like physiology that you should always keep in mind. Like whenever you come up with a clinical possibility of a tetralogy like physiology, these are the differential diagnoses that you should be aware of. That is DVAR with VSDPS, a tricuspid atresia, TGA VSDPS, CCTGA VSDPS, AVSDPS, single ventricle with PS, and some of these heterotaxy syndromes, various left isomerism, right isomerism, all those things are the various possibilities. So how do you differentiate between these variants? I told you the not having a cardiomegaly, one murmur and a single second sound is a typical feature of almost all these conditions. So what differentiate between each of these conditions? I think maybe most of this is taken by Professor Anita Saxena ma'am also in her lecture, but I think there is no harm in repeating it again because this is a very key question that most of the things you will be facing in your exams. So I'm going from the order of merit. Like, I think the most solid evidence is that if you are finding a prominent aortic pulsation in the second left intercostal space, that is where the pulmonary artery pulsations are likely to be, or if there is a situs, situs solidus with dextrocardia, or you have opposite situs inversus with levocardia, all those situations, you can think of an L-post aorta that indicates it is a CCTGA. A pulsation in second left intercostal space must be looked for in all tetralogy like physiology. Another important thing is like a typical LV type apical impulse. A typical LV type apical impulse is characteristic feature of tricuspid atresia, VSD, PS, which will be most commonly encountered disease. And then single ventricle with PS, and then DVRU with restrictive VSD. That means even with PS or without PS can have an LV impulse because in DVRV, both the arteries are arising from RV. Clear? If there is a restrictive VSD, VSD is the only outlet for that left ventricle. So if there's a restrictive VSD, it will behave like something like an aortic stenosis for that patient. It's an LVOT obstruction for that patient. So it will behave like an AS, like it will be concentric hypertrophy. There won't be cardiomegaly, but it can be S3 or S4 will be there. S3 can develop later on if there is heart failure. So, but it can present with cyanosis if there is PH or if there is PS also. So both of them are possible, but it's a very rare diagnosis. But if you find a very heaving apical impulse, an LV type of classical AS-like apical impulse, there is hardly any other differential diagnosis in a cyanotic patient. So tricuspid atresia VSDPS is a common garden disease that I will be discussing in detail later. So two other differential diagnoses, even though technically will not fall in tetralogy like physiology, but both of them with cyanosis can present with cyanosis, especially Epstein anomaly can present in adulthood. A PA with intact ventricular septum, exceptional adult survivors may be there. But generally, these two are conditions which are tetralogy, not tetralogy like physiology, but overall can have cyanosis with LVFX. So these are the differential diagnosis for LVFX with cyanosis. And one more thing that is commonly found is, as I told you, like murmurine tetralogy is inversely proportional to cyanosis. It's clear. But when you find a tetralogy like physiology where murmur is pretty loud, murmur is very loud, but the patient is very blue, when that can happen? That is because of DORV. It can happen in some complex interplay. DORV or TGA can happen. So basically why this happens is because, so most often than not, I will go to another common error that happens in the examination here. So commonly asked question is like, what is the difference between pink tetralogy and a blue tetralogy, cyanotic tetralogy? The most common answers, invariably, I would say around 80% of students in the exams always say that, sir, there is less amount of PS in pink tetralogy. These are, I would say in various places I have gone to, this is the most common answer I get. But you think of it, what will be the PA pressure in pulmonary artery pressure in a pink tetralogy? It is going to be max 20, 25. Systolic pressure may be maximum 30. But what will be the RV pressure? The same like blood pressure, that will be 120. The gradient is 90 at least. So in pink tetralogy also, the PS is severe. So by definition, tetralogy should have PS that is severe. So the severity of PS cannot address this issue of murmur out of proportion to cyanosis unless you think there's an intact reticular symptom. Because this differential diagnosis, we are talking about tetralogy like physiology. That means a large unrestrictive VSD is there, but still the murmur is loud and then proportion cyanosis is there. So why this happens in a DORV is because there is an additional factor of streaming, and unfavorable streaming is contributing to the degree of cyanosis. So there should be an unfavorable streaming. That means more deoxygenated blood is going into the system and more oxygenated coming from the pulmonary venous circuit is going into the pulmonary artery. This kind of a TGA type of mixing is happening. That is why the patient is more bluer, but there is an anterior aorta for some reason or something, then you can have a louder murmur. So that is that. So coming back to the discussion that I was talking about, I don't want to give the answer because all of you will answer rightly, then we can't have this question asked. But still, I think I will give you this answer. Like, what is the answer to this question? Why pink tetralogy is pink and why blue tetralogy is blue? Is the amount of pulmonary blood flow. What determines the amount of any cyanotic congenital heart disease, except in admixture and TGA physiology, is the amount of pulmonary blood flow determines the degree of cyanosis. It's absolutely clear. So with the same amount of gradient, the flow may be different because the resistance offered by different systems are different. So that is the answer to this question. So some of the other things that can happen, even these are all uncommon, but then still you can help you in differentiation between top variants are the murmur of, if you find a murmur of MRR, the systemic AV regurgitation, that is clearly AVSD and CCTGA. If you find an early diastolic murmur of PR, it has to be absent pulmonary valve. If it is a complete heart block, CCTGA, mesocardia, dextrocardia, CCTGA, and then amount of cyanosis can also help you. For example, most of the very blue, very intensely blue generally happens in TGR, where there is unfavorable streaming along with that, TGR, DORV kind of physiologies. And pulmonary artery also will be intensely cyanotic. So less commonly, people are generally well-balanced circulation exists in single ventricle pathways, and most of the CCTGAs will have absolutely can be normal saturation at around 20 years, 30 years is possibly the rule in CCTGA than otherwise. So I think tetralogy, we know the X-ray, but the X-ray and ECG, I'm not going to the detail because of lack of time, but I will briefly touch upon a very few slides on the general principles of management, because oftentimes in a DM examination, this you must be clear. I can't think of somebody coming to the final DM examination any institute without knowing the basic fundamentals of what is the timing of surgery, what is the surgery done for all these congenital heart disease. So that is the basic minimum. So two ventricle repair or single ventricle repair will always be single ventricle if there is a tricuspid valve atresia or mitral valve atresia, or single ventricle with PS is there, only one ventricle is formed, or there's a heterotaxy syndrome, complex anatomies, or generally single ventricle pathway will be there. VSD-PS generally will be a tetralogy like physiology, will always be two ventricle repair. So DORV, TGA, VSD-PS, CCTGA, VSD-PS, AVSD-PS can be variable. So in all these situations, what determines two ventricle versus single ventricle are whether the defect is balanced, whether there are two adequate ventricles are there. Is there any heavy wall hypoplasia or atresia? And then most importantly, whether the systemic ventricle is routable to aorta. These are the various situations in which these are the four fundamental things that you are looking at to determine whether the patient goes into single ventricle pathway or goes into two ventricle pathway. It's very simple, very serious. Like, though we need two ventricles, two AV valves, and the LV should be routable to aorta, and if at all there is a large defect, it has to be balanced. So going beyond this thing, I think, what is the natural history of tetralogy? So another commonly asked question is, why should you operate on a tetralogy who is relatively asymptomatic in the exam or mildly blue? So generally, it is survival rate is around, it comes down by 65 at 1 year, 50 by 5 years, 23 as 10 years, and 4% at 15 years. So this is the survival rate in tetralogy. And tetralogy-like condition is poorer. So I think it should be operated even if it's asymptomatic, and whenever biventricular repair is possible, all even asymptomatic children with any tetralogy or condition, biventricular repair should be done. That is because they all have exceptionally poor survival. So what are the features determining the timing of surgery? So obviously need for surgery, depending on cyanosis and symptoms, anatomy 2 or 1 pump, and need for conduit and expertise that is available. What are the associated lesions like AV regurgitation and ventricular function? So what should be the algorithm that should be followed in children? I think if you know this, two algorithm that should be good enough for most of the timings of surgery. So TOF-like physiology, two ventricle repair is possible. If it is needed, you can go for a palliative BT shunt. Or generally, most of the centers in India are now comfortable to do 6 months to 2 years should be the ideal range for, say, operating a tetralogy with spells on the one extreme to 2 years for a pink tetralogy. So 1 to 4 years in some situations, some centers don't operate ICR, the intracardiac correction repair is not done. The patients are less than 2 years of age in some centers, but most of the pediatric cardiac centers today are operating at 6 months in a tetralogy who are symptomatic and who have cyanosis. And then single ventricle pathway. So commonly we are talking about tetralogy like physiology. We are not talking about the increased flow situation here. We are talking about single ventricle physiology. If both of them need, so for example, in the TOF, if they need some form of palliation, you do either a BT shunt or you can do an RUOT stenting. If there is a PDA, you can consider PDA stenting in today's time. But in a single ventricle pathway, the three common surgery that are done is a BT shunt, a Glenn, and a Fontan. So most of the centers are comfortable, again, operating at around 6 months for a Glenn. Around 6 months, 5 kilo, 6 kilo is a general cutoff used in most of the centers across our country. So Glenn is generally done from 4 months to 1 year. And Fontan conversion happens around 3 to 4 years. Rarely you can actually skip any of them, and patient can actually directly go for a Fontan if the patient comes at around 4 years, if everything is perfect for a Fontan. So it's not a must that everybody has to go through. Suppose somebody presents at 1 year, if the anatomy is suitable, the patient can go for a Glenn. If at 4 years, everything is right, the patient can directly go for a Fontan. If BTG patient has lost to follow up, comes at 5 years, everything, the anatomy, the pressures, everything looks all right, at times can go for a direct Fontan also. So the same when it comes to adults. So the palliatives are only when ICR is not possible, because most of you are going to get an adult in the examination. So the single ventricle pathway, shunt and Glenn becomes not so much useful, because beyond a few years, I think Glenn, the ability of Glenn to palliate a patient actually goes down. So if the patient is very blue, Glenn is unlikely to take the full load. But the problem here is that if the patient is not fully suitable for Fontan, you have very little option but to go for a Glenn and immediately within 6 months or so, immediately convert it into a Fontan. That is the problem. Like, that is the thing that you should be knowing in adults. So I think these two algorithms are good enough for you to know. All of you must be knowing these algorithms. What is the timing of Glenn? What is the timing of Fontan? I would suggest you to go through the recent guidelines published last year by Professor Anita Saxena, ma'am, and all of us through PCSI. That's about timing. That's a must-read article for all of you before going to the final examination. That's in a nutshell summarizes everything about all conditions in pediatric cardiology. So coming to the variant forms of tetralogy now. So we have talked all about tetralogy-like physiology. That means a large VSD and a PS. Now we are coming to intact ventricular septum with PS. This is a fundamental difference. The fundamental difference is there. That is why this question is often asked. How much you understand the hemodynamics? What will be the parastinal heave in PS, intact septum versus PS with VSD? This is a common question in the exam. And you guys will go out and say, what stupid. This was era when nothing was there. Then they were looking at all this. Why should I look at all this? we are not looking at whether you are looking at all this or not. We are looking at whether you have some hemodynamic understanding or not. So if you can't understand this simple hemodynamics, then you are unlikely to understand various other complicated hemodynamics that are there in most of our cardiac patients, right? So that is the reason why this question is repeatedly asked. So it's a fundamental question like PS with intact ventricular septum compared to PS with VSD. Because there is a VSD which is decompressing the right ventricle in one situation, whereas this PS, there is no VSD in the other group, that is PS with intact ventricular septum, there is nothing is decompressing. So every load is taken by RV. So here, unlike in tetralogy, there will be a dominant A wave in JVP, there will be cardiomegaly, there will be parastinal heave 3/3. The S2 will depend on the pathology, where is the PS, infundibular, valvular or supravalvular. There will be RVS3 and RVS4. The pulmonary ejection murmur will be proportional to severity and it will be a late peaking murmur. And there could be a TR murmur could be there. So these are the differences. You put tetralogy, all of you know what is tetralogy. This is how you differentiate between so-called triology, but generally we don't call it tetralogy anymore. We generally call it like PS with intact ventricular septum with ASD shunting right to left. So another common variation that you will see in an adult is pulmonary atresia. When do you suspect pulmonary atresia in an adult? Very simple. When the patient is very blue, you don't find an RV outflow murmur and you find collateral murmurs everywhere in the back. So whenever you do find a murmur, you find a continuous murmur of PDR, a MAPCA, you think of pulmonary atresia. So it can be actually 5 to 10% of tetralogy physiology. The onset of cyanosis is generally in infancy, but sometimes in infancy it can present with heart failure due to increased pulmonary blood flow. This could be one of the reasons why patient could be having increased pulmonary blood flow features in early infancy. The murmurs are actually the murmurs of MAPCA and PDA are over the side of the collateral at the point of stenosis. So they are heard in the right and left of sternum or posteriorly most of the time because they arise from descending aorta. As I told, RVOT murmur is not present and the same thing will be there. So the variation you should always remember is one is VS with VSD, PS with intact ventricular septum, that is triology of Fallot. The second one is pulmonary atresia. And the third one that you should remember is cough with absent pulmonary valve. But commonly in the exam, none of these diseases read textbooks. So they all will have their own findings. So oftentimes you will be asked to ask a tough question, why this is so. This is why I put all of them together. So like, for example, heart failure in tetralogy in adults is found in 15% of patients. Hypertension is found in 6.7%. Aortic regurgitation around 7%. ECG may show LVH in less than 1% of patients. Absence of RVH is found in 3.4%. QVH in lateral leads are found in 8.8%. So these things can help you in some situation that you are finding. You find a tetralogy, there is no RVH in the ECG. You can argue with these findings. So another common question is repeatedly has been emphasized that TOF will not have heart failure. But if a tetralogy patient has heart failure, what are the common causes? The most common causes are anemia, restrictive VSD, AR, ventricular dysfunction. Then comes PR, TR, infective endocarditis, because of ventricular dysfunction, because of intense cyanosis, or surgical shunts, because of collaterals. There can be arrhythmia, there can be hypertension, and very rarely AS have been reported along with TOF. So these are the various causes of heart failure. So remember it like this, anemia is, we all know this, a restriction has to happen at the VSD, because restriction at VSD will increase the RV pressure. So something similar to a PS with intact ventricular septum will start happening. There will be cardiomegaly, there will be parastinal heave, there will be symptoms and signs of heart failure. So though all those things will be there. So some of the teasers that commonly examiners are fond of asking is the prevalence of right isoid aortic arch in various conditions, pulmonary atresia, truncus, all those things are asked. What are the symptoms commonly associated with tetralogy? What is catch-22 syndrome? Why the heart is boot-shaped in tetralogy? Why there is early transition in ECG? What are the post-operative tetralogy issues? And then CCHD is with continuous murmur. So all of this you should be aware. I can't cover the whole of pediatric cardiology. I think cyanotic engine heart disease, especially for adult cardiologists, will be the maximum burden of diseases apart from ASD and the small VSD that you commonly encounter. So what are the causes of continuous murmur in CCHD? So they are pulmonary atresia with VSD, a TOF with collateral, a TAPVC, because you can hear something like a venous hum. Pulmonary AVM can rarely produce a peripheral continuous murmur. Peripheral PS with the right to left shunt, a surgically created shunts, are rarely you can find it in mitral atresia with restrictive ASD. You can have at the ASD side, you can have a continuous murmur. So much for tetralogy and tetralogy-like physiology. I think I forgot to mention about TAF is absent pulmonary valve. It's a very rare condition. Generally, it presents with cardiomegaly. And generally, there will be tetralogy-like features, but there will be cardiomegaly, and there can be heart failure. The most dominant finding will be a 2-1-4 murmur. That is the ESM followed by a early diastolic murmur of PR. So moving on to the next important differential diagnosis that you are likely to encounter is an Eisenmenger syndrome. So many of the examiners are fond of asking about the Palwood series. I just summarized most of the things. The number of large defects, the number with Eisenmenger syndrome, what is the proportion, and how often they... I think for I don't know why this is asked, but repeatedly this is asked. So this is unfortunate tool. This is, I think, Professor Dr. Kodari's slides. I think Sir has documented this 1 year apart. The patient who's BSD, who has been asked for surgery, who's been advised surgery, comes back with this X-ray after nearly 1.5 years time. So things can totally change in Eisenmengerization. It's a process. So it's a cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood pressure and reduced pulmonary blood flow. So it can be because of a large ventricular septal defect, large patent ductus arteriosus, iatropulmonary window, because of atrial septal defect, or rarely you find cyanotic congenital heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, like the TGA, TAPVC, truncus arteriosus. All of them can become Eisenmenger at some point of time. So never make a diagnosis of Eisenmenger syndrome in an infant. This is another common fundamental understanding question is, at what age a large VSD Eisenmenger is? Is it less than 6 months? 2 years, 10 years, or 20 years? So most often than not, I find a wrong answer to this question. Like a typical, I ask you like pink tetralogy versus cyanotic tetralogy. Oftentimes the answer is wrong. Oftentimes in this also, there's no conceptual understanding. Right? The VSD Eisenmengerization is a process. Any condition, any cyanotic congenital heart disease turning into Eisenmengerization is a process. The process starts very early in life because especially in a VSD and a PDA, if it is large, the systolic pressure is going to be the same. So the process, the lung changes starts happening pretty fast, unlike in an ASD. The pre-tricuspid shunt, the pressures are not same. Whereas in a post-tricuspid shunt, all the pressures are same if there's a large defect which is going for Eisenmengerization. Generally, the patient can become inoperable by around 2 years of age. Even though the patients commonly present to you with symptoms of Eisenmengerization in second, because this is commonly written in most of the textbooks. The patient comes with symptoms of Eisenmenger syndrome. That is onset of X-rays induced limitations, cyanosis, all those things start happening, say, around the second decade in VSD and fourth decade in ASD. But the process in post-tricuspid shunt can start as early as 2 months, 2 years, and it can actually start very early in some infants with very large defects in large PDAs and in Down syndrome and various other genetic malformations associated with lung lesions. It can start pretty early. So, it is established by 1 to 2 years of age, except in ASD, but not in first or second or third decade of life. First or second, third decade of life differences, but when they present with Eisenmenger syndrome, when they become inoperable, is pretty early in life. So you should operate before that most of the time. The most important fundamental understanding is that closure of the defect is only detrimental once the obstructive PH has developed. So it's not that there is a last chance not to operate. This, I think, I handled it mostly in the operability issues that we discussed. The median survival is 30 to 40 years in uncomplicated lesions. Most of the times, this is the survival curve. I think most of the deaths happen because of 20% of deaths happen because of an ill-advised activity like pregnancy or medical procedures. So, survival in patients IPA, so unwanted surgical closure can hasten death. So, in terms of clinical identification of an Eisenmenger syndrome, there can be three groups. What are the three groups? The most common that we anticipate as the most common is there is a history of failure to thrive in infancy because they all had a VSD, large VSD, and they were having repeated symptoms of pneumonia, repeated heart failure. And there was once the PVRI started increasing, pulmonary vascular disease set in, the shunting reduced, the cardiomegaly reduced, as I told you in that X-ray, and there's a settled phase. And then the patient comes with a symptomatic adolescent phase. This is what we think is the most common thing. But insidious presentation among various series in India is also pretty equally common. That means patient was never aware about all this in this infancy and has suddenly come to you at around 20 years of age with X-ray-induced desaturation and symptoms. This is something that you need to be aware of. So this is very important. Why this has happened? Because either the patients are the attendant did not notice the failure to thrive, which is quite common in our country, or another possibility that could be there is that they never gone through this cycle because of their PVRA never fall after birth. So there was persistent PAH was there. So hence they did never develop this phase of increased flow through the VSD. That was also possible. The other third group, which is very less common that I repeatedly been saying, is the cyanosis in birth, like a TGR, a TAPVC, or a can present to you in Eisenmenger rarely. Like for example, if you see 100 patients in our institute series, maybe you can find 3 or 4 patients like this with who present with a TA, tracheospiral atresia, VSD with PAH, or truncus with PAH. Truncus with PAH is reasonably common. Maybe you'll find more than 5 patients in a 100 patient group. Like, but it's quite uncommon compared to the other groups. What are the key presentation features in Eisenmenger syndrome? So ASD patients are generally, whenever there's an Eisenmenger syndrome, they are actually cyanotic at earlier age than VSD or PDA because the bidirectional shunting that can occur. So JVP, generally prominent A wave is there in 20 to 90%, but overall Eisenmenger syndrome is ASD is much less common than VSD and PDA. That is why this distinction you should know. The prominent A wave in 20 to 90% of patients, B wave is seen only in 5 to 10% of patients, especially if you have a LV to RA shunt or there's a mitral regurgitation. So commonly, most commonly, heart is not enlarged. The paracerebral impulse may be there. P2 is loud and palpable in 2/3 of patients. This is ejection click in most of the patients. There's EDM of PR in 1/2 to 2/3. 10% can have a thrill. So S2 is single in 50% of VSD, 5 to 20% of PDA, and 20% of ASD. Wide split is common with ASD and rarely in PDA. So commonly, what are the typical presentation features in Eisenmenger syndrome? Cyanosis is generally mild. There is no cardiomegaly. I will come to the differences between various heart failure, except in ASD Eisenmenger syndrome. Minimal or no paracerebral lift. Absence of significant shunt murmur. That means there is no S3. There is no flow murmur. Flow murmur across will not be there. Constant ejection click of PH and pulmonary regurgitation murmur may be audible. So in nutshell, again, here also, except that P2 is palpable and loud, the murmur is generally very, very mild and 2/3 murmur will be there. There could be palpable P2, palpable RVS3 or S4 can be there. Palpable pulmonary artery pulsation is a very common finding that you should always look for, which is often missed in your examination. You don't report this. Peripheral bruise can be there. Especially you look for, why should you look for peripheral bruise in a so-called Eisenmenger syndrome or a patient with PH? Because one of the causes of which can mimic like PH will be a peripheral PS. Or a CT, a PH kind of situation. So actually you should look for them. So you should always know the auscultatory signs of PH, loud P2, whether comparable to A2, as Dr. Kothari mentioned about in the where it is heard is a very important component of how much is it there. And palpable P2 is always abnormal, except in situations where there is increased flow like ASD. RV, S3 and S4, ejection click, constant ejection click will be there, murmur of TR, ejection systolic murmur, murmur of PR are typical features. This, I think, repeatedly has been emphasized. How do you differentiate between low pressure PR or TR and high pressure TR? So this will help you in differentiating many other conditions. And then this is how you differentiate between low pressure PR and high pressure PR. This, I think, have been repeatedly shown by me as well as and many of the other examiners who have taken the lectures. So prominent PR is common feature of PDA with PH. Another common question that comes up is, patient has PH. Patient has a borderline situation, operability. So whether he is hyperdecanatic PH or obstructive PH, most of the things happen in pediatric cardiac situations, very rarely in adult situation. But still you should know, hyperdecanatic PH will have a cardiac size will be larger. There will be shunt murmur will be there and there will be flow murmur will be there. And then the hyperdecanatic impulse will be there. And ASD will be wide and fixed split. There will be wide and variable split in BSD and paradoxical split in PDA could be there because of increased flow. Whereas the opposite will happen in typical Eisenmenger syndrome. Severe PH, VSD, but the reversal has not happened. So there is cardiomegaly, there is severe PH, but yet there is cardiomegaly. So coming to the last point in Eisenmenger syndrome is what are the differences between various forms of Eisenmenger syndrome, that is ASD, VSD, and PDA. So the radiology, typical ASD will have a larger heart, larger prominence of PA and PA dilatation will be there. So this will be a very important feature. I think differential cyanosis will be there. What are the common underlying lesions that are found? So this is a thing most of the time 70% is VSD and around 40% in the other series, like it's around 35%, 40% is VSD, the most common lesion. So these are some of the various Indian series that I have put forth together in Eisenmenger syndrome. So what are the common cardinal defects that we commonly encounter is around various series from SGPGI, AIMS and GB Panth are like roughly around 50% like 50% are VSDs and remaining 25% are ASD and PD. So they all, most of our Eisenmenger syndrome, they all have a reasonably well-preserved 6-minute walk distance, and they are in mostly in 2 or 3 functional class. So coming to the differences, that is the bedside difference between an ASD Eisenmenger, a VSD Eisenmenger, and a PD Eisenmenger. So which one of the following clinical signs is unlikely in a VSD uncomplicated VSD with Eisenmenger syndrome? Single S2, palpable second sound, cardiomegaly, absent parasternal heave. Which is the answer? So yes, the VSD Eisenmenger syndrome. So commonly usual age of onset of Eisenmengerization is around 2 years. There is no differential cyanosis. Cardiomegaly is not there. Only condition that has cardiomegaly is ASD Eisenmenger syndrome. P2 is generally single, but it can be narrow or normally split in PDA, whereas it's generally wide and fixed split in ASD. But it will be narrower than before, but who has auscultated and noted it down, how wide it was been before the onset of Eisenmenger syndrome. Only ASD has cardiomegaly and parasternal heave. TR murmur is more common in pre-tricuspid strands, and PDA pH is more commonly associated with the PR murmur. These are the essential differences that you should be knowing. So coming to the Epstein's anomaly, which I told you like has typical features, has bimodal presentation. I think the whole chapter by itself. But one thing that you should know is about increased pulmonary blood flow situations like TGA. Because for completion sake, I will complete them also. These increased pulmonary blood flow, the most common condition that we see in neonatal age group is TGA. They are generally symptomatic in neonatal age group. Generally, cyanosis is severe. And there is failure to thrive, heart failure, there is cardiomegaly. S2 is single, S3, and there is insignificant systolic murmur can be there. So cardiomegaly with increased pulmonary blood flow in X-ray will be there. So what are the different apart from this increased pulmonary blood flow, cyanosis, increased pulmonary blood flow, that is TAPVC, truncus arteriosus, all those other conditions, like I told you, for tetralogy like physiology, like double outer right ventricle without PS, single ventricle without PS, tricuspid atresia with large VSD with no PS, AV septal defect, all of them can have increased pulmonary blood flow. So what about obstructed TAPVC and HLHS actually can present with pulmonary congestion? This is the other group. Their presentation is generally in the newborn period, lethal unless intervened early, marked respiratory distress and cyanosis. These are all, these group of conditions present with both pulmonary venous congestion as well as cyanosis. There is generally no cardiomegaly, and then difficult to differentiate from the respiratory distress syndrome. There will be ground glass appearance on the X-ray will be there. So other rare group of conditions that are there are, they have normal auscultatory finding or normal pulmonary artery pressure without pulmonary stenosis. They are unobstructed TAPVC that can have clinical features suggestive of ASD, but the patient will be cyanosed. Common atrium will be again clinical features of ASD, but generally have cyanosis of around 85% saturation. And then there is Epstein anomaly, which will have multiple heart sounds and quiet precardium. So other group of condition is cyanosis with normal cardiac examination, where you can think of anomalous systemic venous drainage, unroof coronary sinus or total anomalous or partial anomalous systemic venous drainage, and then pulmonary AV fistula. So echo with saline contrast injection is diagnostic in this situation. Finally, I will conclude with Epstein, like because Epstein has so many myriad features, like it's quite variable presentation can be there, cyanosis or without cyanosis. Patients commonly present with either excess limitation or with episode of tachycardia. It's quite common in Epstein's anomaly. And it has typical bimodal presentation, neonatal Epstein as followed by an adolescent Epstein. And then auscultatory findings are quite typical. But they rarely cause confusion because a prominent outflow murmur generally rules out Epstein's anomaly in the absence of a PS or an outlet VSD. So you don't get a prominent, because most of the conditions that we commonly encounter like tetralogy or Eisenmenger syndrome have a good murmur in the outflow tract, that is the pulmonary artery, there is the murmur. Epstein's anomaly, generally you won't find a murmur. Most of the murmurs will be focused on the tricuspid valve area, and there will be variable amount of cardiomegaly will be there. So actually there is no confusion when you auscultate and when you clinically examine and when you make it out. Because rarely there is any parasternal heave, and there is rarely any outflow tract murmurs. So that way you can easily differentiate. But then typical X-ray, ECG and X-ray, but then there are many X-rays are there. And then arrhythmias are more common, and TR, low pressure TR will be there, and cyanosis will be variable. So I think from an approach and the other common area that you should be knowing about is what are the common issues in an adult with CHD? Because most of the time in the history and in the approach, you will be asked to enumerate the various difficulties faced by all patients with cyanosis in adults. It's a very common thing. So myocardial dysfunction due to cardiac issues. What are the cardiac issues? Myocardial dysfunction due to hypoxia, AV valve regurgitation, dilated aorta and aortic regurgitation, aortopulmonary collaterals, and arrhythmias, both early as well as late, even postoperative arrhythmias, and infected endocarditis. These are the common cardiac issues in adults. Non-cardiac issues are, many of them are there. There is a whole textbook on this, like hematological issues, polycythemia and anemia, neurological issues, commonly brain abscess, stroke, and cerebral venous thrombosis, hemoptysis, renal, arthropathy, both gout as well as pseudogout, that is calcium pyrophosphate deposition, which is maybe more common than gouty arthritis in this group of patients. Pregnancy and contraception is a whole different topic in itself. And what about non-cardiac surgery, employability, insurability, and psychosocial issues are rarely discussed, which issues which are more important for the patient and machine management also. But carefully managed, most of these patients can lead useful lives. So pregnancy and congenital heart disease, a brief mention. So there are absolute contraindication like pulmonary hypertension and Eisenmenger syndrome, severe LV systolic dysfunction, especially postpartum cardiomyopathy, who have residual systolic dysfunction, Marfan syndrome with dilated aortic heart and uncorrected cyanotic congenital heart disease. So what is the outcome of these? I think these are two important papers that you should all know. I think these are the various conditions, how much completed pregnancies happen. Like. So you can clearly say the fontan and the cyanotic actually fare the worst. So I think clearly, for PAVSD, fontan and cyanotic are the worst to behave. Like overall, it's worse than expected. Like. Whereas PS is generally good. This is the worst subset. So risk to fetus, if saturation, less than 85%, chance of live fetus is only 12%. This is the other thing that is recurrent risk of congenital heart disease. These are commonly asked questions, like if the previous sibling has affected the mother. Very nicely summarized table. I think if you know this much, I think you can answer most of these questions that are asked. I think if you are interested, you can go into the references. So I think some of the resources that you can read will be Dr. Jacob Joe's cardiology clinical methods and Professor Goswami's CSA Essentials of PG Cardiology, which are enumerated a lot of things, and then textbook by P.K. Dev, CSI textbook, as well as Rajan Tandon's textbook. They are actually looked at essential features concerning to specific things, specific problems in adults that we are facing. Because most of the other foreign textbooks, it's not a problem for them. 25-year-old tetralogy coming to the OPD is not a problem in adult cardiology clinics abroad. So I think most of these issues are handled in these textbooks. I think... Thank you for your patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Ramakrishnan, for a very comprehensive presentation. And over to our panelists for the discussion. If there are any questions, please type to us and we'll be happy to answer them and discuss with Dr. Ramakrishnan, Dr. Samoor, Dr. Jamal, Dr. Girish, Dr. Arima. If there are any pertinent questions, please get it.
Thank you, Dr. Ramakrishnan, for such a succinct presentation. There is one question while enumerating about the symptomatology in CCHD patients. Should we take NYHA or UCLA classification? What system of classification should we use?
I think it's a tough question. I think there is no classification which actually fundamentally covers all the cyanotic congenital heart disease because the mechanism of dyspnea is different in them. And the NYHA classification or even the UCLA classification may not be adequately cover all the variation that happens because of cyanotic congenital heart disease. In Eisenmenger syndrome, especially in a grown-up adult with Eisenmenger syndrome, it is safer to follow WHO functional classification, which is almost similar to that is used in all PH situations. That is clear. There is no doubt about it. But I think it's better in today's time to stick to NYHA classification, knowing fully well that there are a lot of problems that can happen. There are a lot of issues that are associated with this classification. But I think there is no other classification that characteristically describes. But in an infant presenting with heart failure, I think better to stick to Ross classification. That is quite useful in infants presenting with heart failure. But especially for cyanotic angina disease, I think no classification adequately covers that can be said that this is the classification that we should be following. But I would suggest all the students can follow NHA classification, fully knowing well that these are the lacuna of applying NHA classification to children, number one. And what are the lacuna? What are the lacuna in applying it in a cyanotic angina disease?
Thank you for such a nice presentation. I must say, you must take our classes also, because we should have a pleasure of at least knowing more than our students.
Yeah.
Dr. Rama, go ahead, Smooth.
Yeah, Dr. Rama.
Yeah.
Common issue when an adult is examined is, to say what is the type of apex, RV, LV, so any tips to improve your,
I think by rule, all the cyanotic angina disease will have an RV apex by rule. So if you find a typical LV apex, then will you commit? Because you are putting a lot of money on LV apex, that means it has to be really typical. That means it has to be a ping pong apex coming in between the ribs. It will be producing a good impulse. Then only you should compare and don't go by your retraction, your feel, this, that. It has to be real LV apex to put your money on LV apex in all cyanotic angina disease. So by and large, everything will be RV apex most of the time. So don't put borderline situation, you always err on the side of more commonality. That will be RV apex in this particular situation. All cyanotic angina disease. LV apex is very specifically found in very specific situations. So if it is there, you should not, I'm not saying that you should not present, but if it is not classically there, then never force yourself to say it's an LV apex. So typical differences will always be there where it is localized. Because most of the cyanotic angina disease, there is no shifting. That means RV will be lateral and LV will be down and out. Which is a very useful sign. And then whether it is localized or diffuse, whether it's continuous with the left paraxial heave is there or not. These are the characteristic feature by which you differentiate between LV and an RV apex. But the problem is, unless it is very typical LV, don't commit yourself as typical LV. Because you are limiting yourself to a very limited diagnosis in all these CCHDs.
Then another question being asked frequently is, why the frequency of cyanotic spells decrease after 2 years of age? One is immaturity of the maturity of the respiratory center. What are the other causes?
Because most of the other people will be eliminated. It's a natural history. Most of the people who have a cyanotic spell will not be living. Most of them would have been eliminated. That is the most important cause. That will be one of the most important causes. And then generally they know when to stop, because by 2-3 years, when they started walking and all, then they know when to stop. So once they attain that age, then generally they stop. They don't exert that much. They know when to stop. That could be another reason. So one more thing is that even though people are blue, but spells don't occur. But I have seen spells in adolescents also. So it's not that very, but they need really to be very blue to have a spell. So, but then it's a spectrum, but definitely agreed 2 years, less than 2 years. One other theory is that the myelinization is complete and the central systems don't respond to minor changes in variation in various systemic measures.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Rama?
Yes, sir.
How to manage a swelling fontan? That is a usual question asked by the resident. They want to know the exact answer from your side. How to manage a swelling fontan acutely or...
I think number one, obviously, if any reversible factor is there that you can address upon, that's the most important thing. Sometimes it can be a tachycardia, sometimes it can be ventricular dysfunction, sometimes it can be heavy regurgitation, or there could be a problem in the circuit, there can be arrhythmias, there can be collaterals. That's a number one. So failing fontan by itself is a big topic, it's a whole topic. I think then you realize what is the reason for failing fontan. That's the most important thing. So you need to do a cath and establish what are the pressures in the fontan circuit. Is there any obstruction in the fontan circuit that is causing it? Or what is the reason? There could be pulmonary embolism. There will be some emboli sitting here and there. These are the reversible factors that we always try to look upon. If they are not there, then you look at the pressures. And then if the pressures are high, then actually you can think of reducing the pressure with the specific pulmonary vasodilators. Yeah. That is the other option that is there. And there are various other protein-losing enteropathy, there is a list of treatment that have been tried. there's a huge list is there. I think it's all well summarized in good articles. Like, and then you find out, then if nothing is working, then you can think of some physical measures of creating a opening in the Fontan circuit, creating a fenestration in Fontan circuit. All those things can be tried if out of desperation, like when nothing else is working. But I think all of them can go through good articles that are there in the, again, share the reference with Mohit. You can send the reference, like, the very nicely summarized Fontan failure.
Okay. Thank you.
Rama, one of the sessions that we had earlier on cyanosis, and we had one of the very avid teachers, the common question that is asked is that why there is sudden transition? And that we were answered at that time that this question was asked to Dr. Tanda, and he said there is still no known cause for this particular thing, that why there is a sudden transition that occurs.
Yeah, I think.
What would be a resident answering in this particular situation practically? What would be there? What
so
would
like, I think the problem is that the one of the answers that has been given is that there is a the wherever there is a V2 is placed, there's a big hole is there.
Hole, yeah.
BSD is there. And then that is why, that is one of the many examiners want that as an answer.
Yeah.
The particular portion is missing there, then immediately that is what is picked up by, that is what gives that tall forces in V2. So that is not there. That is one of the answers that can be given. But as most of the teaching in our institute is that it's not known. We really don't know. Because there are exceptions to that rule. Like in some patients where there is no trabecular BSD also, there will be sudden transition.
AST Eisenmenger, we say that the S2 split tend to persist, but there may not be any flow across the AST. AST may be even reversed in direction. So how do we explain the persistence of S2 split in AST?
I think that's a very good question. That for example, in some of the that can be answered very simply, understood very simply by even after ASD closure, when you do it in adults also, the splitting never normalizes in maybe around 25% of patients. That is to do with the increased compliance that has already built into the system. So the system has become more compliant, even if the flow is not there. Like for example, this is the reason why they have increased signs of increased pulmonary blood flow here and there in X-ray. So things cannot normalize. The compliance has increased beyond that. So that's a more important determinant of P2 split than actual flow. The compliance doesn't come down that much. It comes down. Definitely it comes down. That is why the splitting is becoming narrower, but then it doesn't normalize, like. And then there is dilatation. Huge dilatation is there.
Polycythemia, indications of phlebotomy, and what should we be careful about in an adult cyanotic patient?
So generally, the enthusiasm for the phlebotomy has actually come down clearly. So it is very clearly, it should be limited to people whom you cannot offer anything. That means there is not even a shunt is possible. Not even like, for example, Eisenmenger you have to do, but in the rest of the situation, you need not do. So it's not something that absolutely they have to deserve it. They have to earn it. Phlebotomy is earned by the patient. That means the patient has to be symptomatic. The symptoms of hyperviscosity is a must. In rest of the situation, we only do, like for example, if they are going for surgery. So above 65 cutoff with symptoms is a clear-cut indication for doing it. This symptom is a very critical thing. So you're not treating it. It's not a treatment for Eisenmenger syndrome. It is not a treatment for inoperable pulmonary atresias. So if they are absolutely symptomatic, there has to be hyperviscosity syndromes to warrant phlebotomy. Because it is actually associated with, because in our patients, we don't have published data from our patients, but our patients' strokes can be precipitated because many of them are iron deficient anemias are there. So iron deficiency is there. So you are supposed to correct iron deficiency and then do a phlebotomy, which is, I think, not commonly practiced. Like, that's a very common error. And then this is a whole different topic of what is iron deficiency, what are the limits of hyperviscosity, how do you define iron deficiency and anemia in cyanotic congenital heart disease. All this is a different, that needs a whole lot of discussion. And there is no clear answers to all of them.
So thank you, Dr. Ramakrishnan, again for expectedly a beautiful lecture, a very comprehensive lecture. And with almost 400-500 residents who are watching, I think, and personally, we have benefited a lot as usual from your lecture, and residents would also benefit as their exams are near. Thank you so much for joining, and we will definitely catch you again for especially spotters, as you had promised. And my dear friends, next week we'll be starting with spotters. And because your exams are there, the variety of spotters will be shown. And after that, we'll be having another master class by Dr. Balachandra on rheumatic heart disease. So please join us again next Friday, same time at 6 p.m. onwards on this wonderful PG Track program. I would also invite you to submit your Indian Heart Journal Thesis Awards. This is your own awards. You can easily submit. We'll having a double-blinded review. So please feel free to make your research known to everybody and take this opportunity to submit your awards. If you have any questions, any comments, anything you want, any particular topic or any clarifications, please write to us on our email pgtrackcsidelhibranch@gmail.com. And in case you have missed on the lectures, all the lectures, 15 of them, and this one also will be loaded soon on our YouTube channel. You can easily subscribe and listen to all these lectures later on. So thank you so much for joining. Thank you, Professor Jamal Yousef. Thank you, Dr. Girish, Dr. Sumon, Dr. Arima, and thank you, Dr. Ramakrishnan. Goodbye.
Thank you, Ramakrishnan.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Arima. Thank you, Sumon.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.